Hello friends, this video is about learning of terms and concepts used in hypothesis testing. Let us say that average marks in science of class 9 students of ABC school are 85. On the other hand, if we randomly select 30 students and calculate their average score, their average comes to be 95. What can be concluded from this experiment? It's simple. There are two conclusions. 1. These 30 students are different from ABC school's class 9 students. Hence, their average score is different from the population, that is, all ABC school class 9 students. Or in simple words, these are two different populations. And 2. There is no difference at all. The result is due to random chance only. That is, we found the average value of 85. It could have been higher or lower than 85 since there are students having average score less or more than 85. Now, how should we decide which explanation is correct? There are various methods to help you to decide this. Here are some options. 1. Increase sample size. 2. Test for other samples. And 3. Calculate random chance probability. The first two methods require more time and budget, hence aren't desirable when time or budget are constraints. So in such a cases, a convenient method is to calculate the random chance probability for that sample. That is, what is the probability that sample would have the average score of 85. It will help you to draw a conclusion from the given two hypotheses given above. To do this, hypothesis testing comes in picture. Before to start learning of hypothesis testing, let's understand some basic terms in it to make understanding of hypothesis testing much easier. So let's begin. The null and alternative hypothesis. The null and alternative hypothesis are two mutually exclusive statements about a population. A hypothesis test uses sample data to determine whether to reject the null hypothesis. Null hypothesis, denoted by H0. The null hypothesis states that a population parameter, such as the mean, the standard deviation, and so on, is equal to a hypothesized value. The null hypothesis is often an initial claim that is based on previous analysis or specialized knowledge. In the above example, the null hypothesis is the average marks in science of class 9 students of ABC school are 85. Formally, this is written as H0 colon mu is equal to 85. Alternative hypothesis, denoted as H1. The alternative hypothesis states that a population parameter is smaller, greater, or different than the hypothesized value in the null hypothesis. In the above example, the alternative hypothesis is the average marks in science of class 9 students of ABC school are not equal to 85. Formally, this is written as H1 colon mu is not equal to 85. Two-sided or one-sided hypothesis. The alternative hypothesis can be either two-sided or one-sided. Two-sided alternative hypothesis. Use a two-sided alternative hypothesis, also known as non-directional hypothesis, to determine whether the population parameter is either greater than or less than the hypothesized value. A two-sided test can detect when the population parameter differs in either direction but has less power than the one-sided test. The example we had seen above is with the two-sided hypothesis. One-sided alternative hypothesis. Use a one-sided alternative hypothesis, also known as a directional hypothesis, to determine whether the population parameter differs from the hypothesized value in the specific direction. You can specify the direction to be either greater than or less than the hypothesized value. A one-sided test has a greater power than a two-sided test, but it cannot detect whether the population parameter differs in the opposite direction. If you want to see whether the average marks in the science of class 9 students of ABC school are greater than 85, a one-sided alternative hypothesis will be used because you are specifically hypothesizing that marks for students are greater than 85. Here, H0 colon mu is equal to 85 versus H1 colon mu is greater than 85. What are the type 1 and type 2 errors? No hypothesis test is 100% certain. Because the test is based on probabilities, there is always a chance of making an incorrect conclusion. When you conduct a hypothesis test, two types of errors are possible, type 1 and type 2. The risk of these two errors are inversely related and determined by the level of significance and power of the test. Therefore, you should determine which error has a more severe consequences for your situation before you define the risk. Type 1 error. When the null hypothesis is true and you reject it, you make a type 1 error. The probability of making a type 1 error is alpha, which is the level of significance you set for the hypothesis test. An alpha of 0.05 indicates that you are willing to accept a 5% chance that you are wrong when you reject the null hypothesis. To lower this risk, you must use a lower value for alpha. However, using a lower value for alpha means that you will be less likely to detect a true difference if one really exists. Type 2 error. When the null hypothesis is false and you fail to reject it, you make a type 2 error. The probability of making a type 2 error is beta, which depends on the power of test. You can decrease your risk of committing a type 2 error by ensuring your test has enough power. You can do this by ensuring your sample size is large enough to detect a practical difference when one truly exists. The probability of rejecting the null hypothesis when it is false is equal to 1 minus beta. This value is the power of the test. Example of type 1 and type 2 error. To understand the interrelationship between type 1 and type 2 error and to determine which error has the more severe consequences for your situation, consider the following example. A medical researcher wants to compare the effectiveness of two medications. The null and alternative hypotheses are: null hypothesis H0:μ1=μ2. The two medications are equally effective. And alternative hypothesis H1:μ1=μ2. The two medications are not equally effective. A type 1 error occurs if the researcher rejects the null hypothesis and concludes that the two medications are different, when in fact they are not. If the medications have the same effectiveness, the researcher may not consider this error too severe because the patient still benefits from the same level of effectiveness regardless of which medicine they take. However, if a type 2 error occurs, the researcher fails to reject the null hypothesis when it should be rejected. That is, the researcher concludes that the medications are the same when in fact they are different. This error is potentially life-threatening if the less effective medication is sold to the public instead of the more effective one. As you conduct your hypothesis test, consider the risk of making type 1 and type 2 errors. If the consequences of making one type of error are more severe or costly than making the other type of error, then choose a level of significance and a power of test that will reflect the relative severity of those consequences. Confidence interval and confidence level. The purpose of taking a random sample from a lot or production and computing a statistic, such as the mean from the data, is to approximate the mean of the population. How well the sample statistic estimates the underlying population value is always an issue. A confidence interval addresses this issue because it provides a range of values which is likely to contain a population parameter of interest. Now, these confidence intervals are constructed at a confidence level, such as 95%. It means that it is the probability that the confidence interval actually contains the population parameter in approximately 95% of the cases. So, there is a 1 in 20 chance, that is 5% chance, that our confidence interval does not include the true mean. In this pictorial example, the 10.3% conversion rate is the mean. The plus or minus 1% is the margin for error, and this gives us a confidence interval spanning from 9.3% to 11.3%. Let's say 10.3% plus or minus 1% at 95% confidence is our actual conversion rate for this page. Here, 95% is a confidence level, indicating that if we take a total 20 samples, we can know with a complete certainty that the sample conversion rate would follow between 9.3 to 11.3% in at least 19 of those samples. What is a test statistic? A test statistic is a random variable that is calculated from the sample data and used in a hypothesis test. You can use test statistics to determine whether to reject the null hypothesis. The test statistics compares your data with what is expected under the null hypothesis. The test statistics is used to calculate the p-value. A test statistics measures the degree of agreement between a sample of data and the null hypothesis. Different hypothesis tests use different test statistics based on the probability model assumed in the null hypothesis. Common tests and their test statistics includes hypothesis test, z-test, and test statistics is z-statistics, and so on. What is a critical value and p-value? A critical value is a point on the distribution of the test statistics under the null hypothesis that defines a set of values that call for rejecting the null hypothesis. This set is called critical or rejection region. Usually, one-sided tests have a one critical value and two-sided tests have a two critical values. The critical values are determined so that the probability that the test statistics has a value in the rejection region of the test when the null hypothesis is true and equals the significance level denoted as alpha. The p-value is a measure for the strength of the evidence in your data against H0. Usually, the smaller the p-value, the stronger the sample evidence is for rejecting H0. More specifically, the p-value is the smallest value of alpha that results in the rejection of H0. For references, I have taken some part of this very detailed content from Minitab, Convergence Science website, and Engineering Statistics Handbook. Now to end, please like this video if you have found it useful, add your valuable comments, and share this video to your friends and colleagues to improve and refresh their knowledge. If you want to get updates of such a videos from my channel, please do not forget to subscribe it and click on the bell icon and select to get all notifications. And finally, thank you for watching.